We're here with Dr. Raymond Francis, and he is a cutting-edge scientist regarding our health. And you just said that medicine is not scientific, is that right?
That is correct.
Tell us what Dr. Russell Blaylock said about you.
Well, Russell Blaylock, who is one of the top doctors in America, really one of the top medical thinkers in the world, here's what he wrote about me. He said, Raymond Francis is one of the few scientists who has achieved a breakthrough understanding of health and disease. So that's a very nice thing for him to say, but that's who I am, it's what I am, it's what I do. I'm on the cutting edge of health science. Whereas medicine is so far behind the science, it's irrelevant at this point. And again, most people don't know this. Most people think of their doctors, you know, being extremely knowledgeable and up with the very latest that there is. That's simply not true. And study after study has shown that what an average doctor does on a daily basis, about 85% of it, has no basis in science at all.
Shocking.
It's a collection of old wives' tales and anecdotes, and it's not science-based. And that's why it doesn't work. That's why your doctor can't cure cancer, can't cure heart disease, can't cure diabetes, can't cure Alzheimer's. They don't know how, because they're so far behind the science. And even the National Academy of Sciences, look, it doesn't get any more prestigious than the National Academy, looked at this several years ago, and they came back and they said that the difference between the medicine we have and the medicine that we should have based on our advances in science, that difference is not a gap. They called it a chasm. Now, I'm not quite as kind as the Academy. I call it an abyss. And the National Academy went on to say that that chasm is now so vast that there's no way we can take existing medicine and bring it up to date and save it. We've got to discard it and start over.
Wow, that's a big statement, right?
Absolutely. Who knows that? How many people know this? Nobody's telling them.
Just you and me and our watchers, I think, our viewers.
We're shocking people. But it's the truth, and you can go and look it up. And this is straight from the National Academy of Sciences. And so it's we've got to start doing things differently, and that's why I wrote Never Be Sick Again.
Which is going to appear backwards here. Is that backwards to you?
And Never Fear Cancer Again as well. The thing is that all of this human health is so complex. So infinitely complex that to give someone a tool, give the average person a tool to use to help themselves, you've got to take this complexity and simplify. And that's what I've done. I've taken enormously complex biochemistry and molecular biology and simplified it down to concepts that we actually teach to children. And when you teach it to the children, it's so empowering. A child can literally cure almost anything all by themselves.
All right. Now, that's I'm
sorry to interrupt.
That is a perfect segue to talking about one of my favorite subjects, which is milk and dairy products. And you maintain that these are not fit food for human consumption. Is that right?
No, they are not fit for human consumption. Here again, we've been, you know, led down the primrose path and told a lot of things that are wrong. First of all, about 70% of the world's population does not drink milk. Now, most people don't know that. And then there's only a few people who drink a lot of milk, and the Americans are part of that few people. So we're about 4% of the world's population, but we're way up there in terms of milk consumption. So most of the world doesn't drink milk, 70% doesn't drink milk. And then of the 30% that does drink milk, there's only a few percent that drink a lot of milk, and Americans are right up there with those that drink a lot of milk. Americans, Canadians, Finland is very high in milk consumption. And they have enormous problems as a result of it. All of the milk-consuming nations have problems with osteoporosis because milk destroys your bones. Now, that's not what we were told. countries that don't drink milk don't have problems with osteoporosis. It's just the milk-consuming nations. And the more milk you drink, the higher your problems with osteoporosis. So Finland drinks more milk per capita than anybody. They have the highest osteoporosis rate in the world.
Why is it that only you know that?
Well, the dairy industry isn't advertising it.
I should think not. And tell us, you know, in a simple manner, what is it about milk that causes osteoporosis?
Oh, it gets into complex chemistry. Milk is acid in the body because it's high in protein. It has an acid effect on the body. But also, the calcium in the milk is not very bioavailable. Milk, cow milk, has about three times the calcium that human milk does. Yet a baby will absorb more calcium from human milk than from cow milk. So you see, it's not the amount of calcium, it's the bioavailability of the calcium. You see, Mother Nature didn't intend anybody to drink milk. Milk is Mother Nature's perfect food. But it's the perfect food for the infant of a particular species.
For baby cows.
Mouse milk is good for those little mouses. And giraffe milk is good for giraffes. And cow milk is good for cows. And human milk is good for humans. But you can't cross-species feed. If you feed mouse milk to an elephant, you'll make the elephant sick. Mm. And you'll need an awful lot of little mouses to get enough milk. And if you feed giraffe milk to a cow or cow milk to a human, you'll make the recipient sick because every milk is biologically unique, biochemically unique for the need of that particular species. So you can't cross species feed. So that's the first thing you can't do. But then each milk is unique to the needs of the infant of the species. So you can't feed to the adult of the species because it's unique to the needs of the infant. So two things you can't do. You can't cross species feed, and you can't feed milk to the adult. So we're doing it really screwed up. We're feeding milk to adults from another species.
Right.
So we've got it really screwed up. And that's bad enough. That's bad enough. But then we pasteurize it, we homogenize it, we add all kinds of chemicals to it, artificial hormones, and then milk is a toxic soup filled with PCBs and dioxins and hormones and antibiotics and sulfur drugs and pesticides, herbicides. It's a toxic soup.
Not only that, but even, let's say, an organic milk, if it comes from a pregnant cow, you're getting a lot of hormones that you shouldn't get. You shouldn't get pregnant cow hormones, right?
Right. Doesn't even have to come from a pregnant cow. You still get hormones. And, of course, now they inject the cows with hormones in order to get more milk. So, and those hormones cause cancer. Of course, it's only a side effect, so if you don't mind getting cancer, it's okay to drink the milk.
What did a famous pediatrician had a quote about milk? Can you cite that quote?
I don't remember the quote exactly offhand, but I believe it was something to the effect that, if there's one thing we could do to help, improve the health of our population, it'd be stop drinking milk.
Yeah, I think that was it, exactly.
Stop drinking milk.
So what are the other deleterious effects besides cancer that we're seeing from people drinking milk?
Well, diabetes, a very strong connection with type 1 diabetes, and then osteoporosis because, it destroys your bones. But it also, milk is highly allergenic, and so it causes allergic reactions, and then the allergic reactions reduce your immunity. And that makes you susceptible to infections, it makes you susceptible to cancer. It just goes on and on.
Let's talk about those allergic reactions for a moment, because a lot of people who drink milk may be having the reactions and may not connect them to the milk because it's just, what, eczema, or it's just, what else?
Well, anything. You can have almost anything. Your nose can run. Your eyes can itch. You can get a twitch in your in your cheek or your hand or a muscle twitching. Or you can get a skin eruption. Or you can just feel tired and not have energy. It can literally be anything. An allergic reaction can produce almost anything, including hemorrhoids. I mean, you can actually get hemorrhoids from an allergy. So, and about, at this point, it's estimated that about 50% of the U.S. population is allergic to milk.
And when we say milk, we mean cheese and yogurt and rice pudding and all of those things, right?
Yes, all everything that's made from cow milk.
Is there any form of cow's milk that would be less allergenic and harmful?
Yes, and that would be, you know, cow's milk as it comes from a healthy cow. You know, fresh cow's milk, freshly milked from a healthy cow, would be less damaging.
Unpasteurized.
Yes, unpasteurized and unhomogenized. The pasteurization and the homogenization, these both change the chemical and the physical structure of the milk. So we think of them as, you know, benign and good. And actually, they do damage to the milk and make it more toxic. They make it much more toxic.
Okay. What about goat's milk?
Well, goat's milk,
Oh, we got a problem. Are you there?
I'm here.
Okay, go on. I didn't hear what you said about goat's milk.
Okay. I was saying that chemically, goat's milk is much closer to the chemical composition of human milk. So that if you wanted to drink a milk, it's still not a good idea, but if you wanted to drink a milk, goat's milk would be a better choice because the chemistry is closer to the chemistry of human milk, whereas cow's milk is radically different from the human chemistry.
Okay, and what about fermenting cow's milk into yogurt or kefir? Does that change? Does that make it any better for us?
Well, normally it would, but in the cow's milk that we use today, the answer is no. Normally it would. For example, if you were to take goat's milk, for example, healthy milk, fresh milk from a healthy goat and make yogurt out of it, that actually be a decent food.
Okay. All right. And you know what everybody's going to say. How can I get my calcium from a food if I'm not drinking milk? So what's the answer to that?
Well, very simple. Where does the cow get its calcium? The cow gets its calcium by eating greens. Now, here we have elephants don't drink milk, and they have huge bones. You know, a rhinoceros doesn't drink milk, has huge bones. Where does it get from eating greens?
However, we know a cow has, what, two stomachs or more?
Right.
We don't.
But that doesn't really help. And you don't, you know, as I said before, a baby will absorb more calcium from human milk than it will from cow's milk, and cow's milk has three times the calcium. So, you see, cow's milk is not a good source of calcium for a human. It's a good source of calcium for a cow, but not for a human.
Okay, so is kale a good source of calcium for meat?
Kale is excellent. Broccoli is excellent, you know, and nuts and seeds, you know, all these things contain calcium in highly bioavailable forms that are very good for you.
Okay, and let's talk for a moment about vitamin D, because we need vitamin D with calcium, right?
We absolutely need vitamin D, and the primary place to get your vitamin D is from sunlight. And if you live in a northern area and you don't get sunlight in the winter,
yes,
you need to supplement. And I live in Florida where we have sun year-round, and I still supplement every day with vitamin D.
Can we ask, what do you use? I've started using a liquid vitamin D. Is that good?
I have a liquid vitamin D. We sell it at Beyond Health. The Beyond Health brand sells the liquid vitamin D that is very highly bioavailable and biologically active, and that's what I take every day.
And how many IUs do you recommend?
I take 5,000 IUs every day, and I think that's a good amount.
Okay. All right. That's a very good coverage on the topic of milk. Is there anything you'd like to add?
Well, it's just people need to get over the fact that milk does a body good, because that's been drilled into their head. And maybe if we've at least planted a seed here today saying maybe it isn't really good, then we've done our job.
All right. I like that very much. Thank you, Dr. Francis.